Even as physicists, you might have appreciated that we have had a turning point over the last 10, 15 years towards interest of the society towards biology and medicine. And this is a cover of Time a few years ago. And this interest is not only by the media, but also from the lay public. This is an advertisement of one of the leading pasta producer companies here in Italy, the Cecco, who in the most sold newspaper over Italy made this advertisement where pasta has the shape of a double helix DNA chain. And this big transition started in the 70s with what's called the recombinant DNA revolution, where simply it was acknowledged that all living beings have genetic information based on DNA. You can cut DNA in small pieces, you can transfer this DNA to other organisms. So you can transfer DNA pieces from man to bacteria, from bacteria to flies, from flies to mice. And that was rendered simple by a procedure called DNA cloning, by which you can transfer pieces of DNA. And the major biotechnological contribution of this, so use these technologies to produce something that is useful for mankind, was an enormous development in the capability of producing drugs for human therapy. This started in 1982 with the production of insulin. There are now more than 170 million people taking insulin produced thanks to recombinant DNA. And then there was a tremendous increase in the number of drugs. You can read them here. I won't go into them in detail. There are all interferons, vaccines, hormones. There are now over 150 drugs that are produced thanks to genetic engineering technology. Then in the 80s, a scientist in Cambridge, UK, Cecil Mistine, Nobel laureate, discovered the possibility of using biotechnology to produce antibodies in the laboratory. These are the so-called monoclonal antibodies, and this has been another enormous revolution in the field of application. This is a partial list of monoclonal antibodies that are now used only for cancer therapies. And if you take statistics, this is a statistic from a survey company in the United States called Vantage EP, who surveys the pharmacological market. This was published in spring this year. These are the top selling medicines, and each of these has a sale of about $10 billion per year, and up out of the top 10 medicines that are sold in the world, 7 of these top 10 are biotechnological drugs. There are 5 monoclonal antibodies and 3 products obtained through recombinant DNA, DNA cloning, and genetic engineering. So there is really a revolution of this, and our founding fathers were really clever in starting asking the question, well, if these technologies started in the 70s and the 80s with the very successful establishment of big biotech companies in the United States who made a lot of million dollars through the application and selling of these products, well, who would think to the developing world? What can we do to not to allow the gap between the developed and developing world increase? And upon this concept, the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology was funded through a series of steps that started in the 80s. The first big meeting was in Belgrade, Serbia, in 1982. And at the end of the story, the center was funded in 1987 here in Trieste, with the idea of being a sort of hub for training, teaching, education, and also product development towards the benefit of developing countries in the field of biotechnology. And in the meantime, biotechnology has expanded a lot, because not only biotechnology thinks of health application, as I told you so far, so production of biopharmaceuticals or production of vaccines. Vaccines are one of the fields that are most successful. If humanity will be able to tackle with the problem of Ebola now, that would be only thanks to genetic engineering for the production of vaccines. The vaccines that now being tested and clinical trials will start in the population of the West Africa by the end of the year with 10,000 doses. Is a vaccine produced by NIH and a big pharmaceutical company, GSK, which is a virus that through genetic engineering has been removed of its virulent genes, which were substituted by a couple of genes taken from the Ebola vaccine. So the top standard genetic engineering product. But as I was saying, biotechnology is not only for health, but it's important for agriculture, it is important for the environment in terms of sanitation and bioremediation, and now it's very becoming very important as a production of biofuels. Again, an example taken from our laboratories in New Delhi, India. This is a satellite view of India, where with a color scale you can see the regions where the in the soil salt is very high and drought is very high. So these are regions where it never rains and there is a lot of salt. And here there are millions of people living that have no possibility of cultivating crops. What can we do with this through genetic engineering? Well, we can simply take plants that will grow very poorly and engineer this plant through the expression of three subsequent genes that allows these plants to grow in conditions where there is such a concentration of salt in the soil that it will never allow the natural plant to survive. So basically ICGB now is a system composed of three big laboratories. One is here in Trieste, where the headquarters are also located. Another one is in India, and a third one in New Delhi, and the third one is in South Africa. There are 64 countries worldwide that are supporting the centers, and these countries are those depicted in green here. As I told you, in the 70s, the center was born with the idea that it should be supported by developing countries, but now this definition is becoming very loose, because these supporting countries include Brazil, include India, include South Africa, include Argentina, and so where the definition of developing, developed or transition comes is very difficult to define. A big question that I want to tackle in the last part of this talk is, well, what's next? What's next? These are the biotechnologies that are invading the biotechnological field and the medical and agricultural field. Look at this mail that our director for external relationship received this year. This is a mail from the executive director of the African Academy of Science. And basically, the director of EAES is saying that he would very like to our involvement at ICGB in an initiative on cell biology and regenerative medicine, because Africa feels the need to build capacity in the field of regenerative medicine that is envisaged to play a big role in the future to improve health in areas like skin cover for burns, muscle bone loss, corneal regeneration, hemoglobinopathies, spinal cord injuries, or myocardial regeneration. Would have you thought 20 years ago that these were the real problem for Africa? And the reason why this is happening is simply because Africa has had, and all the developing world has had, a tremendous jump in life expectancy. This is our life expectancy. You know that there's been a tremendous increase over the last century, and now Italy is scoring very well. In Italy, a man lives an average of 80.5 years, and a woman 85 years. But what's most remarkable is that this tremendous jump has occurred also for other least developed countries. For example, the top six countries where life expectancy have increased were Liberia, 20 years increase, Ethiopia, the Maldives, Cambodia, and Rwanda. The jumps of 10, 20 years in life expectancy, which means that since our life as human species is not immortal, but we have a fixed limit at 120 or 125 years, that all the 7 billion people of the humanity are starting to reach this limit. Nobody knows what this limit is. This is one of the most fascinating mysteries in biology, why the life expectancy of a man is set as 120 and that of a mouse at 2 years or a rat 3 years and so on. But the fact is that as we approach with invaluable limit, then several problems come out, and these are problems linked to the incapacity of our body to tackle essential problem of regeneration, renewal, and repair. So basically, we lose progressively our capacity to regenerate, and this is the reason why medicine in the next century will be a medicine of chronic conditions. So people die of heart failure, people have arthrosis in their joints, people that have diabetes, have Alzheimer's disease. In one of the beautiful talks this morning, we heard that there is an estimate of 20,000 people estimated to die because of earthquake in the next decades. Well, heart disease alone kills 17 million people every year. I have a colleague in the United States who addressed the audience, asking everyone to look at his neighbor on the left side, his neighbor on the right side, and decide who of you three will die because of a cardiovascular disorder. 30% of the population. If you think this is a problem of the developed world, would be wrong. These are the statistics of the World Health Organization, 2014. 80% of death because of myocardial infarction or stroke are in low and middle income countries. And the reason is very simple. In our heart, there are several billions cardiomyocytes, the contractile heart cells in the heart. You can recover these cardiomyocytes. These are beautiful cells that contract 3 billion times in a lifespan. You can push them to divide. You will never succeed. People have tried for 40 years to have the heart regenerating, and they already fail. We are born with a certain number of cells, and our programs are not that to regenerate the heart. The brain is even worse. We are born with 25 billion of neurons, and we lose 80,000 neurons every day. So I'm losing neurons here speaking, you're losing neurons listening to me, but that's the biology. If you make some calculation, a person after 80 years has lost about 10-12% of his brain cell content. And we have no drugs and no solution. The least drugs for heart failure, which is a consequence of myocardial cell loss, have been developed in the 90s. It's 20 years we don't have a drug. For the brain, Alzheimer's disease and dementia, drugs are zero. To regenerate the beta cells in the pancreas for diabetic people, zero drugs. To regenerate cells in the retina, with 30% of people after 75 don't seeing well because they are blind, zero possibilities. Zero possibility to regenerate the cells in the inner ear. And so basically, the big challenge, and that's a message that I'm going to keep time, is that this is a big challenge of biotechnology. So to find solutions for these incurable diseases that are affecting the vast majority of the population. The reason why we have no drugs, it is because it's very unlikely that the standard pharmacological companies can address biological problems that are so important and complicated, like cell and tissue regeneration and organ reformation. And small biological companies usually are used to develop small drugs, which are very effective in inhibiting something, but not in restoring complex biological programs. And so the idea is that biotechnology, the new biotechnology, might help in this. What does it mean? It means that if I have a pancreas with no beta cell or a heart where there is a huge myocardial infarction, I can think of injecting a gene inside this heart that might promote regeneration of the lost portion of the myocardium, or might promote regeneration of the beta cells. Or instead of these genes, I can culture in the laboratory stem cells and have these stem cells that become myocardial cells or pancreatic cells, and then I can transplant these cells. Or I can find a growth factor that can be injected in a patient to convince his body to perform his job. That seems to be a very futuristic, but on the contrary, it's a very attainable approach, because all of our organs have been generated once when we were in the womb of our mothers. So the matter and the challenge is now simply to try to understand which are the biological programs that were active at that time and try to recapitulate them. And this is the last slide I'm going to show you. This is just from some our work, just a beautiful picture that show a normal heart. This is the left ventricle, the right ventricle, and this is a completely regenerated ventricle after we inject simply a short stretch of RNA which push the heart cells to regenerate and start replicating again. And with that visionary idea, I stop, and thank you very much for your attention.
Well, fascinating, yes. I admire how much you kept the time, and that left one or two questions. Please. Any question?
Yes.
I didn't see it. Alain Aspect. Microphone, yes.
Okay.
you gave an example of genetically modified plant to solve the problem of cultivating in dry places or something like that. Unfortunately, as Edouard knows better than me, in my country, in France, there is immediately strong reactions against any kind of genetic manipulation. How do you appreciate the strength of opposition on a more global scale? And in particular, in, as you say, what we still call underdeveloped country or other places, is there also this kind of reactions or not?
Oh, that's a central question. The same happens also here in Italy. There is a strong reaction. If you speak about genetic manipulation to cure children with the disease, that's appreciated. But if you speak genetic manipulation for food, that's really elicits strong reaction. The issue is that this is a sort of a spreading concern. There is a famous example of a country in Africa where people die because of hunger that refuse to receive food from the United States for the fear that it was contaminated and so could be bad for health. It is essentially a matter of education, a matter of education. And I think that all the GMO debate should be put into its right in right channels. Let's speak about GMO opportunities in terms of economical sustainability and damage, possible damage to the environment. These are good arguments to speak about. Let's not speak about harm for health, because there is no basis for that. Africa is a particular problem because there the need for good education is particularly pressing, and we have been supported over the last 5 or 6 years very generously by the Bill Gates Foundation to do something that we believe is very important. So to teach and train the legislator and the administrators of what genetically modified organisms are, in order for the government to approach the problem on an informed basis and not just as a gut reaction to something that is not understood. And I believe that this should be the way to proceed.
Thank you.
I couldn't agree you more. There was a statistics recently on GMOs asking people, what do you know about GMOs? And there were several people saying, well, I know this, I know this, I know this. And this small percentage of people were very knowledgeable of what. And then the final question was, would you eat GMOs? And the answer was no. So you cannot tackle, yes. I completely agree. That was part of my education term. I agree.
Luis, a very short question, please.
There are some animals like the gecko where when they cut an arm, they grow it back. I mean, does anyone understand the biological mechanism behind this or how to...
We are doing some work in zebrafish, which is another animal where, you can, for example, you can cut a piece of the heart and this regenerates completely, or the salamander does the same. And there are biological programs. The big difference from these animals that are coming out right in these in these years is that this animal have a heart which pumps against a lower pressure than mammals and don't have the need of an efficient perfusion to survive. So a fish can survive and the heart doesn't pump for a few days. So they have time to regenerate. A mammal has evolved a system to repair the heart through a scarring mechanism because it doesn't have time to regenerate. And this is a way to say that if we are able to recapitulate these programs in invertebrates into mammals, we would be able to do regeneration also in mammals.
Thank you very much. That's fascinating.
Thank you.